Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to our very first Moodle Academy webinar. And the topic for this month is make the most of Moodle forums. And we have about an hour. We want to make this very interactive, so we hope that you will join in the comments in the chat, asking questions and giving your thoughts. So speaking to you is myself. I am Mary Cooch. I'm education manager at Moodle, and I'm coming to you from a surprisingly sunny north of England in the UK. And I have with me Anna, if you'd like to say something.
Yes, I'm Anna, and I'm Anna Crossa, and I am the MSC coordinator. And I just want to welcome you and thank you for being here in the first webinar of the Moodle Academy.
That's great. Okay, now, what I always like to do when we start a particular session is before we say what we are going to discuss, I'd like to cover what we are not going to discuss, actually, to be absolutely clear here. So this is an intermediate webinar about forums. So we're not going to discuss the basics on turning on the editing and how to set up a forum and the different forum settings. There are plenty of YouTube videos and courses and documentation out there. Instead, what we are going to discuss about is how to, and I'm reading here, initiate, promote, encourage, optimize, monitor, moderate, facilitate, make the most of a forum. So we're looking at this from a pedagogical, a good practice point of view, if you like. And I would encourage you after this webinar to go into the course which is attached to this and do the activities there and get a facilitating forum badge. So those last two verbs there, moderate and facilitate, they're often used interchangeably. And in fact, in our webinar, we're going to talk and cover both. But if you want a specific definition or how they differ and how they are similar in Moodle, well, moderating from a Moodle point of view, a forum moderator, and this is often someone with an editing teacher role in a course, they have the permissions to edit a post after the time is up, for example, for a student, a learner. They can split posts and move them. If they go off topic, they could delete something which is inappropriate. And they have the rights to send a private reply to a learner. Learners can't send private replies to each other. They can't actually reply to a private reply. But this is a useful feature for a forum moderator, often the course leader or an editing teacher. It's a bit like a police officer role, if you like, policing the forum, whereas a forum facilitator, and this is often the same person and is often the person with editing teacher rights, doesn't have to be though, but they have a nurturing role or a more a caring role of trying to engage the participants, to encourage them, motivate them to discuss and continue discussing, go in more depth and keep them on topic. So that's really how I would see those two roles, but we're going to look at both during this session. So assuming then we've decided we are going to set up a forum in our course, what are the benefits of a forum over, for example, a video conference or Moodle chat or messaging or something even outside of Moodle? And although we are not going to look specifically at the mechanics and the basics of setting up a forum, it might be worth just reminding ourselves of the different types so that we can discover which we like and the benefits and advantages and drawbacks of all of them. Now, for me personally, one reason, the top reason why I'm a big fan of forums is the fact that they give you time to think. They are asynchronous. You don't have to, as you do in a live session or a live chat, you don't have to immediately think and type your answer. You can reflect upon it. And you can come with a more considered answer after a few hours or a day or whenever. And for some people who perhaps lack confidence or whose language or writing skills aren't as confident, that's very useful. Talking about writing, of course, in a forum, with, for instance, the Atto editor, you don't only have to type your answer. You have the option to record a video or to record audio as your forum contribution. And of course, in the great spirit of Moodle and social constructionism, you can use forums as a great way of building your community, especially at the start of a course or the start of a seminar. You've got forum search that you can search, you can reference, you can add a permalink. And other reasons that are not immediately obvious, one of my favorites, for example, is for a simple way of doing peer review. Now, Moodle's workshop activity is very powerful, and that's the official way of doing peer assessment, but it's also very complex. And yet with a simple forum, each person can start a discussion and share something they've created or written, and others can respond, reply, and comment on it. You could even add ratings. Very straightforward. And this idea of peer support, again, a forum works very well with that, where a group can help each other. Or it might be that in your particular specialism or situation, you have to just use a forum for giving information, as in the announcements forum. And I'd be interested to know, when we start our discussion in a short while, how many of you find the announcements forum very useful, and how many of you actually, as I've done often in the past, just don't have it in your course at all. It depends, doesn't it? What we have here are the types, the standard types of forum. I've put announcements at the bottom because, of course, it is a forum, but it's not one where students or learners respond. It's mainly for the teacher to give news or information. If you don't do anything at all in your Moodle course, when you set up a forum, you will get the standard forum for general use, which is fine because that's exactly what it is. It allows anyone to start discussions and reply to discussions. However, if you think your learners might risk going off topic or they need to be focused, you could use the single simple discussion forum, where you, the course leader, the teacher, can ask a question and all they can do is reply to it. They can't start their own forum discussion posts. This is very good, I found, because I taught nearly 30 years in a high school for younger students who could go off topic. But you do have to be careful with this because the layout or the navigation as you see it on the course page can sometimes be quite strange or confusing depending on where the participants choose to reply or which comment they reply to, and also how you've chosen to have the forum displayed. If we're allowed to have a favorite forum, I have to say my favorite is the each person posts one discussion, because it very much allows people to take ownership of one discussion post, which, for example, they could use in a peer assessment task to share something that they've done or to share a link. And then others can reply. And so each person has their own little forum area. I do know that the Q&A forum, which I don't use a lot, but many people find that popular. Please do share the types of forum that you use and which you like. The Q&A forum is great if you want to avoid participants simply copying from what other people have said, because a learner has to respond themselves to what the teacher or facilitator has put before they can see the responses of others. And again, there are some drawbacks with that. And depending on how you like to see your forums in a course, there's also the standard forum displayed in a blog-like format. So you see a little summary of each one on the course page. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to pass over to Anna. Anna, if you'd like to share your thoughts on a forum and also tell us a bit about what people have been commenting in the chat.
Yes, absolutely. Well, I'll give some time to everybody to write their thoughts about forms and what form types you use in the forums, in the chat. And I'll start by saying two examples. The first example of good use of forums is the announcements forum. Very common, it's always there. And I must say that I used to use it in a corporate environment where the courses were in a weekly format. And we used to use those announcements forum to give the pace of the course. So we were creating one post to summarize the week that passed and inform learners about the new subject of the next week and the tasks and everything. I have to say, though, that if you're going to use announcements form like this, you have to be careful. Don't overdo, because learners seem to be quite negatively reacting to many multiple announcements form. Remember that announcements form can clutter easily the inbox. And also the post need to be small, not too long, because learners don't seem to read long, long text, especially when it's an international audience. And as you said, I have another favorite forum, the one different from yours, is the question and answers. And I love this forum because it can really be very useful when it is to use it for assessment. So, for example, I remember once we had a course, it was English for Business. And we had adult learners working, not being, using English as a second language. And we had an activity where they had to rewrite a passage to simplify it in plain English. And Q&A was just the perfect tool because it allowed them original submissions, rewriting the passage, and also of easy grading, and at the very end, bonus points, they could see each other submission. That was really, really nice. Now, let me see what is everybody writing in the forum. We have, okay, Peter says that single discussion is very useful in a blended course, where you can set a topic where students can react to it in the online time. You get back to the input in your next classroom session. Very nice idea. Alex says that mostly standard forum is the one he prefers. Kim, mostly standard forum, and each person posts one discussion forum. I can see that your favorite wins here. mostly use standard forum, but students do not use very often. I use Moodle in a company. Understand. Perhaps it's more self-paced courses, says Robert. And Sam says that I use announcements to push information to all participants. And for assignments, I use single forum. And for general discussion, I stick with the general discussion forum. Peter says that standard forum with option to upload documents for peer review. Great idea.
Yeah.
Rita says, okay. Hello, Rita. Don't worry. Peter says everyone posts one discussion, maybe for everyone to introduce themselves. Great idea.
Yeah.
Alex, we have our set to send all announcements messages to students at 5 p.m. every day. So announcements would be a great way for us to send urgent messages.
Yes. Yeah.
Nice setting. It is nice to avoid getting a million messages throughout the day, though. Yes, that's a clever idea indeed. Caroline, Q&A is great for question problem of the week post where students show their working and solution. Yes,
that's
indeed.
Another one for you then, Anna, isn't it? That's your favorite. Yeah. Okay. I think we'll move on. And if we obviously, Anna, we can discuss some more later. We're going to look now, since we've decided we're definitely going to use a forum in our course and we've decided which types we're going to use, we're going to move on to discussing code of conduct. Now, obviously, we'd like to think that everyone has a code of conduct. If not for the forum specifically, then for your whole course, and perhaps your code of conduct is something that has been implemented by your organization, or maybe you've designed it yourself and students have to agree to it. Or maybe, as happens with some people, you get your participants at the start of your course or your semester, your year, to agree between yourselves what the code of conduct is, and then you write it out, draft it, and they agree to it, thereby having more of a sense of ownership of this code of conduct. Would be very interesting also to know, what is the content? What kind of things do you think are important to keep or to include in one? I have an example for you. It's not typical in that this is the Moodle.org code of conduct, forums code of conduct. And of course, Moodle.org is a global site with courses with forums in many different languages. So it's relevant to us. But one point that I would like to make further down in this code of conduct extract, and the link will be in the course as well, is choose an informative subject line. And I think that perhaps should be in all similar codes of conduct, because say, for instance, you have a forum where you encourage your learners to ask questions. There's nothing worse than a post which comes up as "help" in capital letters, or even "urgent help," you know, which is not only a bit annoying, but also it doesn't give any indication as to what the problem is. And it's much easier, especially if you have a lot to go through and be able to see what it is the specific problem is. So in a minute, we're going to discuss that, and I'm going to ask you for your thoughts. But before we do, I'd just like to have a little poll here to do with codes of conduct. And I'd like you, just very quickly, when I launch this, do you actually, assuming you have a code of conduct, do you agree it with your course participants? Or do you use a pre-existing one, maybe one that your organization has done? Or do you not have a code of conduct? That's fine, it is anonymous. So please do tell us what your answers are. I'll just wait a minute and then we'll see what we get. Okay, interesting. I will reveal the responses shortly. We'll just wait a few more moments to get more participation here. So who discusses and agrees one? Of course, it might not be possible to do that even if you want to, depending on the institution where you're working. And maybe you hadn't thought of using a code of conduct, or you can trust your learners implicitly already. Perhaps we shall see. Okay, I'm just going to wait another moment. It's actually quite interesting how the percentages are divided up here. Okay, right. So hopefully if I just share the results now, please tell me if you can actually see these. Can you see these results? Can you see them, Anna?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's very interesting. It is actually kind of similarly divided, isn't it, between agreeing one, using a pre-existing one, or actually not having a code of conduct. That's very interesting. So bearing that in mind then, let's go back here. And I'm going to pass over to Anna again, and maybe we can discuss that and have your thoughts and the thoughts of our webinar participants on codes of conduct.
Well, you see, I think things are mixed. Mm-hmm. In adult courses, and particularly in corporate environments, I rarely see a code of conduct being set up just for the forum discussions of a course. Usually it is a wider corporate general code that applies to all the courses and of course the forum as well. But on the contrary, in school courses, particularly in small ages like primary school, yeah, where teachers want to train young students to online communication and prevent flames and cyberbullying incidents, in this case, we usually see teachers to invest time on training students about netiquette and setting up a common together one netiquette for the forums. And let's see. Okay, Peter is, John says that yes, I have a code of conduct. And Peter says that he's looking for the code of conduct from Moodle org. And thank you, Ellen, for passing it by. And Alex says that I deal mostly with adults. I trust them. Yeah, this is typical. No need to have a conduct code, but I'm sure it may be very useful sometimes. Indeed. Some says that I'm in a learning and design department in a learning and development department, sorry, in a workplace, and we make a deliberate policy not to be viewed as too controlling. It's hard enough getting them to enroll on courses. That's true. BipLab says that for mature students, it is implied. For younger students, it should be explicitly written, I think. I agree. That's also my experience. And John says that we use similar to Moodle.org, but with additions of exist to provide a safe and friendly place for members to learn, share, and socialize. We encourage freedom of speech, but we expect our members to treat others with respect and courtesy. Don't write something that you won't be prepared to say to someone. Respect confidentiality, stay within the legal framework, and be aware that safeguarding, libeling, slander, copywriting, and data protection laws apply. Bad language, profanity is not permitted. Any form of prejudice is not permitted. And you should be mindful at all times that Motorsport UK regulation and UK law continue to be applicable in the online environment. So true, John. Thank you for the detail. Caroline says that, I guess we assume adults know how to behave, but perhaps the point about informative titles or other points about the content is important in a code of conduct for adults rather than the behavior parts.
I agree, actually. I wanted to make that point when it was first mentioned, Anna, that I'm not sure we can assume that adults don't need a code of conduct, because it's not only about how to behave and how to be polite. It is things like, oh, John's reading my mind there. It is
indeed.
It is also to do with netiquette in terms of writing informative subject lines, or even things like writing in full sentences instead of using SMS, text, or WhatsApp abbreviations. I was in a Moodle course for my master's, and that was part of the code of conduct. Please write in like official English. This was because our forums were graded as part of our master's, and don't just write as you would send a message to your brother or your sister on a text, for instance. So interesting. Thank you for that. Let us assume then that we've got our forum set up and our learners have agreed to the code of conduct. So it's the first day of a new course, or the first day of a new semester, or a new induction for our company. Do you have any activities for breaking the ice? For example, breaking the ice meaning activities which can make people feel comfortable in a new environment. And this might be a new environment in a new course, even if it's a blended course, and they might see each other in a face-to-face environment as well. So do you have such activities? How do you do it if you feel that you need it in your particular courses? I'm going to give you two examples that we've used, and then pass it over for your ideas. So one thing that we did last year, that it's not our idea, a lot of people do it, but it works really well. We run, Helen Foster, who's also here, and I, we run the Learn Moodle Basics MOOC twice a year for people completely new to Moodle around the world. Now, last year we had a special edition, which actually lasted 3 months, because the whole world was locked down. And of course, many people had to use the phrase we use in English, pivot online to online learning using Moodle. And we had the idea of asking people to share the view from their window so they could see. So we get some great photos of different seasons according to where you were in the world, what hemisphere. We had a lot of pets. There's someone's cat in the middle there. Of course, people weren't obliged to do this. And if they didn't have a window, they could share the view from their basement, what was on the wall, a notice board or so on. And it worked really well for that, as I mentioned at the beginning, social community aspect of Moodle, building a community within the forums there. And that was very nice. Also easy to take a picture with your smartphone and add it. Another activity which I've done in courses, and in fact, we did this in Moodle HQ a while ago. It doesn't only have to be when you're with people whom you've not met before. You can also do this with people you know, just to get things started. And that is the two truths and a lie activity or game, if you like. And this is where my favorite forum of each person posts one discussion topic works very well, because each course participant adds a new discussion topic with three statements, one of which is a lie. And after a certain period of time, you can then tell them, they all try to guess, and then you tell them which one was the lie. And this is quite fun, but also allows people to get to know each other, to get to know them better if they did, if they already knew them before. And of course, you, as the course leader, the forum facilitator, you should join in as well with three statements about you. But what I just want to emphasize here, and this activity, this icebreaker activity is a good example there, is that it doesn't have to be typed in text. You can see there the Atto editor in Moodle, where if you don't want to, as our student Mark here, you don't want to type, you can record yourself in a little video, or you can record audio instead. So you've got the universal design for learning aspect of different ways of expressing yourself there. You have the choice. And so just a couple of my thoughts there, but I'm going to ask you, Anna, what's your experience of icebreakers when they're needed? And let's see what people in the chat have got to say as well.
Well, as you said, Mary, the most common icebreaker is they introduce yourself, but can be enhanced with a photo or saying something special about yourself, what you like, what's your preferred coffee, your favorite dessert. And little things like that are very powerful, because this way learners can really correlate it to each other, and this is a good beginning. One not very common icebreaker I've seen is the sharing of five songs of different styles, and learners had to pick one song and express justify why this is their favorite and why they picked that one. That was, it was an indirect way of meeting each other. It was really interesting. And you can do this with songs or other kind of artworks or travel destinations. One thing that a bit concerned me when we use icebreakers is not to overdo with icebreakers. So I often like to use as a last question in an icebreaker to ask a learner's expectations about the course. So after we chit-chat about other things, I would like a line that will help them return the focus back. The course.
Yeah, yeah, that's great. Bring the focus back. I like that. Yeah.
Let's see what we have in the chat, because we do have several messages here. Alex says that.
Could I just say before we start, Anna?
Yes, please.
At the end of our little discussion about code of conduct, Richard popped up and said, avoid irony and sarcasm. And I did want to say that publicly. That's a very good point, because it's not only in terms of the code of conduct and people discussing. It's in all aspects of using a forum, not only because, of course, it's polite, but you may well have course participants whose first language is not the same as your first language, and they won't necessarily understand your sense of humor or your cultural irony or sarcasm. And so if we are facilitating forums of any types, that is something that we should bear in mind, including icebreakers, which I'm going to pass over to you again, Anna, to look at what people have said.
Indeed, very important comment. Well, Alex says about the icebreakers that video session is the best icebreaker. And Robert says that in most cases we have a kickoff session, video conference session, where we practice small talk for 10, 20 minutes. This is very powerful indeed. Says that I haven't used yet icebreakers because all of my people know each other. However, I always recommend that icebreakers should only be used if they are directly related to the course topic, not as what some may consider gimmicks.
Gimmicks, yes, gimmicks.
Okay. Caroline says that speed finding a session with breakout rooms in a video conference with a directed question for a live icebreaker. Mm-hmm. For asynchronous forms or weeks are great, but the questions need to be directed. For example, what famous person would you like to have dinner with? Why are you starting this course? Rather than back, tell us about you. Mm-hmm. I totally agree with this. It also helps if the facilitator kicks off by posting their own. That's a very good point, Caroline. Some say that I think sometimes icebreaker put people off. It might have the opposite effect that intended. Yes, we need to be careful with icebreaker. I agree with that also. Caroline also agrees with Sam's comment. Robert says that once I did Ugly Cup challenge, very good, where every participant has to show up in the video with a really ugly coffee cup. And I remember that was used in the Global Moodle Mood as well. It was really funny competition.
But what if you don't have any ugly cups? That's the thing, isn't it? You know, but you have to go and buy one, so... Interesting.
I was very desperate to find something, to be honest. Okay. Jessica says that I find icebreakers important as it's good to understand a little more about fellow learners, even when it's not related to the course. No worries, Sam. I'm Greek, so my English are weak at some points about the work of gimmicks. No worries. Linda says that yes, usually to introduce themselves in the forum with some questions to inspire them. During an online live session, I would ask them to tell something new, not course topic related. Last book, what would you do within 1 million euro? Usually works very well.
Great. I already know what I would do with 1 million euro because I often lie in bed at night thinking, planning it out, how to divide it all up, but it's not going to happen. So anyway, thanks, Anna. So let's assume then we're in our forum. They've signed the code of conduct. The ice is broken. So they're starting the discussions. They're starting posting. And the next thing I want to discuss is something that's very close to my heart for a couple of reasons, actually. And that is if you are the if you are the course facilitator, moderator, if it's your course, so you have to respond in forums, do you have a set time within which you promise to respond? For example, 12 hours, 24 hours? Or are you the person like me, which is actually quite a bad habit? You're so keen and enthusiastic, you go and jump in immediately and answer all the questions that are posed? Or do you have a preference whereby your course participants help each other and respond? And the time is very, very important because, again, from my own personal experience, if you have courses where people are welcome to ask and answer amongst themselves in the spirit of Moodle, then if one person, even if it's with the best of intentions, answers all the questions immediately they get the notification, you are kind of robbing other people of the chance to reply, aren't you, when they would like to have helped. Sometimes this happens in our Learn Moodle Basics MOOC. Again, with the best of intentions, we have expert Moodlers who are, again, with their enthusiasm, they will immediately reply, and other people then don't get a chance to reply. And from my point of view, as a language speaker, I also think this is important. The last few years, I've tried to answer questions because I can't get enough Moodle questions on Moodle.org. So as well as the English speaking forums, I try to answer in the French, German and Russian forums. Now, the French ones are fine. I'm okay at French. But in the German and the Russian forums, when I read a question, I understand what it is. And most often I know what the answer is, but it takes me a few minutes to craft the response in my head, or maybe check it on Google to make sure my grammar won't embarrass me. And it has happened that in the 10 minutes it's taken me to make sure my answer is grammatically correct, the forum moderator or someone else, a regular, has replied. And I think, oh, I could have answered and I've lost my chance. So I do think you have to get a good balance with the response time between not answering immediately, but also not neglecting things for ages and ages. Maybe your organization has a specific time. When I did my master's, for instance, we were told that to expect a response if we had a query in a forum within, I think it was 24 hours, so within a working day. So what do you think about this, Anna? What's your preferred method? And what do our webinar participants think?
Well, as you said, it depends on the type of forum. I mean, if it's a forum to solve questions, the answer should be fast, like within 24 or 48 hours, depending the environment.
Yeah.
And it is important, as you said, to declare that these learners in advance, so they are aware of that. On the other hand, if the forum is like a collaborative task between learners and the speed of social constructivism, then teachers should leave some space to learners to interact with each other. And again, if the forum is created for reflection, I'm not sure it will have to be responded at all.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Perhaps we can just step back and respect everyone's contributions. So what do you think, everyone? Let's see. Risa says, yeah. Hard to believe that anybody answers before Mary.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, they do in the German and the Russian. So just beware if you're in those. But yeah, okay.
And Sam says that it depends on the course. I always let them know what to expect from me. I usually promise to respond within 24 hours. However, I will sometimes tell them that I will let the conversation run and only intervene if an answer with a legal repercussion is wrong, but I'll try to get them to discuss why. And I can totally understand this. And Alex says that I used to monitor my forums and answer just twice a day, in morning and evening. I think that's fast as well.
Yeah. I guess also there's the idea, and we started a forum discussion in this, in the course itself, actually, and I encourage you to go and look at that afterwards, about what is your preferred subscription method for forums too. Do you have, as I do, a post or an email or notification for every forum post you subscribe to, or do you have the daily digest? Do you have auto subscription? Do you force people to subscribe, which I wouldn't have thought many people do, unless it's an essential part of the course. But it's worth thinking about, and please add your comments, if not here, then in the course later. We have moved on now, as you can see. We've moved on from the response time. We've decided an optimum response time. We're allowing our participants to respond as well. And our forum is going fairly well, but occasionally it gets a little bit quiet or a little bit stuck. And we, in our facilitator role here of nurturing, we need to try to encourage the discussions to move on. We need some of them to be a little bit more profound to get more detail. So let's think about how we can do this, the kind of language we need to use, and also whether we need some kind of extrinsic or external hooks to get them to post more, such as ratings or gamification. So I'll just give you a few thoughts of mine and then I'll open it up. Now, I personally, I'm a big fan of sandwiches. I know this looks like a burger, but it's the best I could find for a sandwich. And this comes from, again, many years as a high school teacher, having to speak to parents who would come to ask about the progress of their child when their child was perhaps a slightly more challenging than average child. And so you would also always try to give your feedback, and this applies to if you're giving feedback in a forum, by offering something positive, first of all. Thank you for your thoughts, very interesting. Put the constructive criticism in the middle, the thing you want them to improve on, and then finishing off again with something positive, the sandwich method, if you like. I do appreciate, however, that this is a cultural thing, and in some cultures, the belief is it's far better to be direct rather than to couch your requests for improvement or your corrections within something nice and sweet and kind. But it's a thought, it's a discussion point. And while we're talking about language, in order to get the discussions further, to get them to elaborate, something more open-ended than simple yes, no questions. So what do you think about this? A why question, a what is your experience question. So these kinds of things, making them think to get them to come back and give you more detailed or longer responses, particularly if you're running a course where there is some element of assessment or grading of the forums, which is a little bit of a plug actually for a webinar Anna will be doing later this year on assessment, and forums is one of those. And of course, what if you have a forum running very nicely with a nice community atmosphere, but they go off topic? How can you bring them back without having to split the forum? Let's get back to returning to, and so on. And then finally, do you think it's necessary, or do you actually do this yourself, to encourage participation, to use things like ratings, rate a forum post, even if it is, and this is what we have on Moodle, useful, just one rating, useful, which either you, the teacher, the forum facilitator, do yourself, or you enable ratings for the learners and they can rate each other. And what about gamification? What about a badge? Is it a good idea to award a badge for participation in a forum? You might think it is. We certainly do in our Learn Moodle MOOC. But doesn't that mean that you might have someone who simply writes, hi, a one-word post, and they get automatically awarded a badge? Is that worth it? Well, I will stop and move on to Anna. What do you think? And let us know in the chat.
Well, Linda posed a question here about an idea that Greg mentioned. So I'm going to explain this a little bit. You see, in courses that are based on social constructivism, the cultivation of community is essential, and forums is just the perfect tool for this. And in a course like that, in a corporate environment, we had an international audience. I've seen forums to be used as a tasks. And there was a requirement for participants to make one new discussion, answering specific questions, and then they had to reply to other to their peers, giving a meaningful reply. And that was several years back when we didn't have that advanced grading in Moodle forums. And the facilitator was rating the basic discussion up to, in a scale to 0-8. And the maximum score that could someone get was 8. And was also giving 1 point to each of the meaningful replies. So this way, someone could gain up to 10 points within the forum. And I must say that although the participants were chasing for the grade and they were contributing to gain the grade, the result was really positive because at the very end, they were getting into the mood to reply and start collaborating with others and do meaningful replies, not just "well done, I agree with you," it was not accepted. So this is the concept. Now that we have the advanced grading, Linda, in Moodle forums, we can do this. We can review per user all the forum posts that has done, give them a grade, and also give them a feedback for their contribution. That's what was Greg saying. And let's see what others say. Some says that ratings, definitely, yes. I think participants appreciate A, the feedback, and B, which discussions are popular. I would like to have a better way in Moodle of using ratings for more resources and activities than those currently available. I think it's a good bite, the grading. Alex says that badges are cool, but you have to be very careful with it. More badges available, less motivation to obtain just one more. Indeed. Interesting question from Greg. Are ratings feedback?
Sort of. A type of feedback.
Yeah, I would say sort of, but if you consider to give ratings using a custom scale, for example, "well done, this is great," or "excellent work," or something like that, and instead of using a scale, a point scale to do your feedback, then you can do an actual feedback with ratings. Aritza says that I found forum ratings cumbersome, hard to set up. the Moodle Swiss Army knife effect. Yeah. Everything is possible, but it may not be so easy to set up. Really? Well, it depends on who's facilitating, actually. Sam, an answer to Greg. I agree that the quality of the feedback is more akin to popularity, but it might encourage engagement. Indeed. And Alex says that I provide them with an example and the rubric so they know what to expect. Yes. They heavily give feedback on their first post and I wear off from too much feedback as the course continues. I would love the option to do partial points like 0-5 in ratings for partial grade credit. I think that's possible with the rubric as you did just. Give 0.5 for a level. And
okay, thank you. Well, we're coming near the end now. And interestingly, our forum has been going very well. We had our icebreaker. We've been doing the best nurturing we can. But unfortunately, as often happens in life, despite our best efforts, we have some problems. And so our last thing to think about here is how do we deal with problems, such as from the fairly minor going off topic? Do you gently bring them back with certain phrases, or are you the ruthless type who would split it and move it? What about the big problem of the internet itself, really flaming, deliberately posting things to annoy people or cause controversy and disputes? How do you handle that if you have that as a problem? And of course, this might not be an issue if your course or your site isn't open, but what about spam if you do have open courses? I'll just share with you another link from Moodle.org. Again, this is freely available in our developer docs. We have many moderators. We have a lot of people in the different courses who help us on Moodle.org. And so we have moderator guidelines. Feel free to read ours, where we talk about how we deal with spam or how we deal with flaming or personal attacks. So do you yourself, do you actually prefer to take a subtle approach? Are you the gentle person who would send that little private message? Or would you, as I've been in forums where this happens, would you immediately suspend someone? Would you have some kind of punishment for them? This happened to me, and I was so upset that I actually left that forum and I never went back again. So I'm going to launch our final poll. Please, would you let me know, you yourself, do you prefer a gentle approach in forum moderation? Do you prefer the tough approach? Or, and I suspect we might get a lot of these, does it really depend? You cannot say one or the other. It depends on the situation, on the course, on the individual participant. I'll just give a moment for people to respond, and then I will share the results with you. Okay. Interesting. I can see the results, and quite interesting what we have. Yep, let's see. So let me share them. And Anna, this is what we have here. So if you'd like to comment on them, and then, so we've got half say it depends, and then the other half-ish, subtle or tough, more subtle than tough, I would say. Okay, fair enough. So we're going to finish then in our last little discussion here about you. Anna, how do you feel about moderation problems? And let me ask the rest of you in the webinar chat in our final 5 minutes.
Well, I would say it depends.
Yeah, I would say it depends. It's true.
Yeah, that's really true. But I think I'm more in favor for tough approach. See, what I want from forums and what I believe it's essential for the good of the class is to have clear forums. And for example, sometimes icebreaker can go a long way. And instead of adding value to the class feeling and the community, they might start disturbing learners and disorienting them. In such case, I'll like to step in and say thank you for your contributions. That will be really interesting. We have moved on, so I'm locking the discussion. That's enough. And I let people to move on. Sometimes I think you have to step a foot on it. And let's see what we have in forums. Edward say that in the chat, Edward say that I teach teenagers and it's better to have a private discussion so as not to embarrass anyone.
Absolutely, yes.
Very important. Some says rudeness. I will tackle the individuals involved privately. Great, yes. And I have another input from Richard. Richard says that one of our most common problems is about language.
Yeah.
What languages are permitted? If some use minority languages, others will feel excluded. If some insist on dominant languages, others will be undervalued. Language policy is key indeed.
Absolutely, Richard. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Thank you very much for raising that.
I think in such cases, perhaps it would be nice to have separate groups inside forums for different languages. Sometimes
it
could work.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, everyone. We're actually coming up to the hour and coming to the end of our webinar now. And so we very much appreciated your input. Just to say before we stop and before we stop the recording, that please do go to the Make the Most of Moodle Forums course and join in the activities there, claim your badge. Please, if you haven't already also, do sign up for the other webinars. Anna will be running the next couple and they're on assessment, including something to do with forums. And thank you for being part of the launch of the very first Moodle Academy webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.